Would you please rise and join us on another glorious, just by a show of hands, how many of you think it's a glorious morning? How many of you hate the cold, but the coolness? It's beautiful. God has made us a day. This is my favorite kind of day in the whole wide world. Here we go. I'm waiting, Nathan. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back.
Decision we can make is decision to follow Jesus. Thank you for being here today. It's so good to see you as brothers and sisters in Christ, to worship the living God, to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ together. For those of you worshiping with us from home, thank you for being a part of our service today, and we pray there'll be a blessing to all of us as we seek to praise our Savior Jesus the Christ. A few announcements to share. I'm excited. We're going to have our scavenger hunt discussion tonight. It's going to be for lesson one. We're kind of rebooting it. It didn't work out last week, but it gave me another week to get ready, so I'm grateful for that. And so we're going to look at lesson one over Zoom at 7 o'clock, discussion about creation and what God's Word has to say about that. And then I'll send out next week, so you can get ready for lesson two as we prepare for that for the following Sunday. The men's Bible study is also going on at Wednesday morning at 8 o'clock, again by Zoom, and we are in the book of Numbers, and I'm going to kind of cherry pick a few chapters, some of the more interesting chapters to talk about, so we'll look at one of those this coming week. And then this coming Friday night, I'm excited, hopefully, good Lord willing, we'll have nice clear weather, and we'll be able to finally watch a movie outside using Alan's giant 16-foot screen, so you can bring your own chair. And we'll have some drinks and some sodas and waters and so forth. And we're going to watch the movie called I Still Believe. And it's based on Jeremy Camp's life, his Christian musician. He and his fiance, she's battling cancer. And it's really it's kind of a tearjerker, but it's also a really heartwarming, inspiring story. It's a great message to it. So hope to see everyone there this coming Friday. And speaking of Fridays, I want to thank Vicki and Taylor for leading our Beautiful Noise concert last Friday, and it really was fantastic. They did a beautiful job with it, very inspiring music, and well done. We had a nice turnout. It was just fun to be together as brothers and sisters in Christ and praise God through music. So thank you so much, Taylor and Vicki, for leading that. It was really wonderful. Another event coming up is a week from today on the 27th. Tim and Donna Malloy have agreed to have a cookout over at their house for the youth, and it's going to be really nice. And anyone can come. We're going to have we'll have some burgers and hot dogs and so forth, and just hang out together. And it'll be from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock, and I'll circulate some information about that. But it'll be a really nice fellowship. So look forward to seeing you all at that. And then once again, the ladies are preparing for a Bible study called Trustworthy, and it's going to start on October 14th. And Barbara Chenier is asking for, if you want to participate in the Bible study, then let her know, and she can order a book. The book costs $16, and she'd like to know by September 25th, so she has time to order all the books. And then finally, we've selected the 4-Day Movement to be our Mission of the Month for September. And the 4-Day Movement's doing an amazing job in helping people in so many ways in our community, and particularly in distributing these food boxes. You know, with COVID going on and people facing unemployment in greater measure than usual, there's lots of needs out there. And 4-Day has been amazing in just serving people in our community, being the hands and feet of Christ. And so this is a way for us to kind of help them do that by providing this financial donation to purchase groceries. And by the way, if you guys just want to bring canned goods, if you want to bring peanut butter and jelly or soup or, you know, non-perishable, we can certainly use those things to assemble additional food boxes as well. So that'd be another way to help. So thank you for considering that. But we're here today to worship the Creator of the heavens and the earth, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. And so I want to ask Pastor DJ to come up and lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning, church. So good to see your smiling faces out there today. Us in these masks. At least we have smiling eyes. That's right, my wife. I would like to mention our youth, too. We have still been Google meeting. We had a really awesome situation yesterday where we couldn't get anybody on but three people. But God was intentional. He was very intentional. And within that particular Google Meet, there was some God moments. So we thank God for that. And I'll be honest with you, I'm so ready for us to open up. It's nobody's business. I can't wait to be in the presence of these young folks, because we are going to worship like nobody's business. We're going to sing like nobody's business. And I challenge us to do the same here in the house of the Lord. I have the pleasure of doing our call to worship this morning, which comes from Psalms chapter 61. Psalms chapter 61. Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you are my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy. Let me abide in your tent forever. Find refuge under the shelter of your wings. For you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Prolong the life of the king. May his years endure to all generations. May he be enthroned forever before God. Appoint steadfast love and faithfulness to watch over him. So I will always sing praises to your name as I pay my vows day after day. How beautiful. Thank you for your word, Lord. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, good morning. And how can we not say good morning and thank you? Lord, we thank you that you have such a compassion over all of us, your children. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for loving this fallen world so much that you gave us your beautiful son. Thank you, God. Lord, I pray on my heart this morning, even as our beginning prayer was, I want to pray for the lost. For those who have come to realization that there is nowhere for them to turn, I pray for the lost. Heavenly Father, we also pray that you would bless this service. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would fall down upon us because some of us need some freshness. Some of us need some newness. Some of us need rejuvenation and restoration, dear God. So thank you that that is taking place today. Heavenly Father, even as we pray right now in this building and we pray over the internet, dear Lord, and maybe there's somebody that's just flicking through and they just are hearing this prayer right now. Lord, hear their prayer, O God, as we come before you wanting a fresh anointing upon us and your people. Thank you for protecting us from the plague and from all other distractions and all other diseases and all other things that would keep us away from you. May this day be a new day for us, Father, for we are honored to be in your presence. Bless our pastor as he brings the word, and bless us, Lord, as we prepare to worship through music. We ask this and we believe what we pray. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
You ready, Jill?
Am I ready, Jill?
Are you ready? Would you stand and join us, please?
When we walk with the Lord, in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Not a shadow.
That was two songs, Ryan.
That was two already? I was enjoying myself so much I forgot that was two songs. All right. I guess I got used to it with the concert of singing a whole bunch of songs in a row, so. Okay, please join me in prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the joy it is to sing your praises and just to honor you through the gift of song and to express our hearts through the beauty of music. We thank you, God, for all the talent that Taylor and Vicky and our whole team brings and as they lead us in song. And we thank you for the joy and sharing fellowship together as we offer our hearts as brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord God, you are truly worthy of our worship and our praise. You are good and holy and righteous and true and majestic and glorious and wonderful and awesome. And we are in awe of you. We thank you, God, that you watch over us. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you are this good, good Father that protects us and provides for us and is with us in our times of joy as well as times of sorrow. We thank you, Lord God, for your Son, the Word made flesh, who came to live among us, to dwell among us, to be one of us and to show us what it is to be fully human and to show us what it means to fully and faithfully love you as our Father in heaven. We thank you, Lord God, that in spite of our brokenness and sin, he came to love us and to forgive us and to provide for us a way of salvation, the gift of eternal life through faith in his name. Lord God, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Christ, family and friends today who are struggling right now, and we trust them entrust them to your care, Lord. We pray for Susan's nephew, Nick, who's suffered such terrible health issues, and we pray, God, that you would do a great work in bringing him physical healing. And we pray, Lord, that you would draw him close to you, that through the work of your Holy Spirit, he would know your love as a good and perfect Father, and that he'd come to a saving faith in Christ. Lord, we pray for Sierra, who's had some health issues, and we pray your blessings be upon her, that you strengthen her and heal her and give her good health. We lift up Cynthia to you, Lord, as she continues to look for a job and is anxious about that. We pray that you give her peace that surpasses all understanding. And we pray for her as she has her dentist appointment coming up, that you take away any anxiety that she may face with that as well. God, we lift up Linwood to you, who's been battling cancer, and we ask, Lord, that you would make him well, that you'd bring him healing, and that through this time of trial, he would know your faithfulness and your love and your presence in his life. God, we continue to pray for Gabrielle, and we pray that you encourage her and that you fill her with hope, and that your Holy Spirit, Lord, would just bless her with a deep sense of joy that comes not from the circumstances of the world, but it comes from your abiding presence and your promises that you give us in your word. Lord God Almighty, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters in the faith who don't have the comforts and the blessings and the relative ease of life that we take for granted here in the States. And I'm thinking particularly of Christians in Nigeria who've been facing severe persecution. People have been put to death, taken into captivity, terrified. And we pray, Lord, that you'd protect your people. And we pray that you give them strength to endure these trying times, and that they, in the midst of persecution, would be incredible witnesses to our Savior Jesus the Christ, and their light would shine brightly in the midst of darkness. We lift up to you also brothers and sisters around the world who are persecuted in so many places, and just ask that you give them the strength they need to endure. Lord God, we thank you for Kwetu Faraja in Tanzania and the incredible ministry that Paul and Lori are leading and how they're changing lives to the work of your Holy Spirit and leading these boys to a deep and rich life following Christ. And we pray that you would help them to continue to grow and mature and become men of God who build your kingdom and transform society in Tanzania. Lord, we lift up to you our youth here at Cornerstone and PYM Squared, and we ask your blessings upon them, God. And I thank you for Pastor DJ and Ruthie's efforts to bring this group together, even as we're driven apart by COVID, and help them to continue, help each of us, God, continue to love them and nurture these kids, and to help them experience the love of Christ through the life of community, through the gift of fellowship, through the experience of sharing life together as brothers and sisters in the faith. We thank you for the Malloy's kindness in hosting this cookout next week, and we pray that it'd be a great blessing for all who come, and that many would come experiencing the joy of being together. God, we pray for the four-day movement, and we thank you, God, for all the ways that you're using this ministry to demonstrate the love of Jesus. And we pray that it would not only fill stomachs, but also fill hearts through the work of your Holy Spirit. Fill hearts through with your hope. Fill hearts with faith. Fill hearts with love. And that many would come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, and that you would be glorified in that. Lord, I thank you so much for the privilege it is of sharing your word. And I thank you, God, for just putting this sermon series on my heart, and pray that you help us to, in seeing how the world is portrayed through the good doctor, help us to, in contrast to that, see the great truths given to us by the great physician, our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Word of God. Lord, I pray that this message would ring true in our hearts and lead us to a closer relationship with our Savior, and I pray that it would be a blessing to each one of us. God, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that you call us into a relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. And as we seek to follow him more closely, we lift up to you this prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, our text for today's message is from the Gospel of John, and we're going to look at John chapter 1, verses 10 through 14. And of course, this text is the author John speaking of Jesus, who is the Word made flesh. So I want to invite you now to listen carefully to John chapter 1, verses 10 through 14. John says, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of the, who were born not of blood or the will of the flesh or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, so as we've been going through this sermon series, The Good Doctor and the Great Physician, and by the way, I think this is going to be my second to last one. I think next week will be our last one in this series. But as we've been going through this series, what we've been doing basically is looking at how the world is portrayed through this popular TV show, The Good Doctor, and how it portrays certain social issues that are really important in our society these days, and then contrasting that with what does the Word of God teach us about these issues. It kind of, by comparing and contrasting, hopefully it's giving us a sharper understanding of the teachings of Scripture, what Jesus teaches us about things. And I hope a secondary impact or secondary effect of going through the sermon series is helping us to have kind of a keener awareness or realization of how deeply TV and movies and music impact our view of the world. And so throughout this series, basically we've been looking at these social issues that are addressed in The Good Doctor. Well, today we're going to look at Season 2, Episode 1, and this episode is called Hello. I'm going to take a little bit different approach to this message than I have in the previous ones. And instead of really looking at a social issue per se, I really see this episode as being almost like an allegory. You know, if you read, like I think Nathan has been reading recently, Pilgrim's Progress. That's like the classic allegory. You read the story, but it's not just about a story. It's a story that points to some deeper truths about God and our faith and our walk as followers of Christ, that kind of thing. Well, in this episode of The Good Doctor, of course, the writers don't intend this to be an allegory. That's not their intention at all. It's not a Christian show. You know, Dr. Murphy's not a follower of Christ. But I realize that this particular episode really could serve itself well as an allegory. And we in this text, we talked about Jesus being the Word of God. He's at the right hand of the Father. He's filled with glory and splendor. And he leaves that all behind, this great privilege. He leaves that behind, and he goes down into the world to be among us sinners and to relate to us in order to save us. And in today's episode, Dr. Murphy and Dr. Kalu, they leave their position of prestige and authority and respect in this state-of-the-art hospital. And they go down into the depths and the darkness and the loneliness that's found in this tent city where people who are homeless dwell. And he dwells among them. He relates to them and has compassion for them. And in that sense, it's almost allegorical. He's almost representative of what Jesus does for us. On the other hand, we see that Dr. Murphy in this episode is very human. And he wrestles with the same kinds of things that we wrestle with. His mentor and his friend, Dr. Glassman, has been diagnosed with terminal cancer, and he can't deal with it. He doesn't want to share in the suffering. He doesn't want to address the struggle. He doesn't want to acknowledge the reality that his dear friend is dying, and he distanced himself from that friend rather than being close to him and showing him compassion. And so in the same character, we see on the one hand, Dr. Murphy is almost like this Jesus-like figure who comes down to share compassion with those who are in need. On the other hand, he's very human. He's very much like we often are in his struggle to be compassionate and to set aside his selfishness and his own fears and his own sin to be engaged in this loving relationship with someone he cares deeply about. And so on the one hand, the good doctor gives us a depiction of Jesus and his divinity. On the other hand, it gives us an example of humanity and how sin is evident in our selfishness and in our fear. And so Dr. Glassman, he has diagnosed with cancer. He's been diagnosed as being terminally ill, maybe 12 to 18 months I think he has left. He's not serving in the hospital anymore, but he is still working. He's actually kind of organizing this clinic, this health clinic for kind of down and out people. And there's a mobile component to this where they've got kind of a mobile home that's been fixed up to be a medical facility. And he sends Dr. Kalu and Dr. Murphy from the hospital down to this tent city in the midst of this down and out area of the city. And Dr. Andrews was the chief of surgery. He's been promoted to be the president. And he's not very excited about this deal because as president, he wants everything to go well, he wants the hospital to prosper, and he's afraid this is going to be kind of a money pit. He doesn't want to spend all this money on homeless people. He wants the books to look good for the hospital. And so Dr. Murphy and Dr. Kalu, they leave their positions of prestige as doctors, and they go down to this tent city where no one else wants to go, and they go to care for the lost and the suffering and the confused. They go to this place where people often end up dying alone. And in this early scene, Dr. Murphy he's in the tent city and surrounded by all these homeless people wandering around, and he's taking care of this one particular woman. And she's got like an infection in her foot, a little wound in her foot, and he's addressing that. And she's just filthy, just dirty. And he's trying to work on his communication skills. You know, his autism, and Dr. Andrews told him he's got to communicate better. So he's trying to relate to this woman, trying to communicate with her, and trying to show sympathy for her and kind of, you know, show that he is like she is. And Dr. Murphy actually was homeless for a while when he was growing up. If you know the backstory of the show, he and his brother ran away from home because they were abused by their father. And so this woman, he says to this woman, well, do you live in a tent? And she kind of nods. And he says, I used to live in a tent. It wasn't very nice. But then we moved into a bus. And he says, you should move into a bus. Like, this is this great advice. The place to be is a bus, right? Abandoned bus. So he's trying to connect with her, trying to relate with her. And this little detail of the story is interesting to me because in verse 14, speaking of Jesus, John says, the Word became flesh and lived among us. And many of you probably seen this before in Bible studies. When it says Jesus lived among us, that literally is he tabernacled among us, or he spread his tent, is literally what it says. Jesus is living in a tent among us. He's living in this temporary dwelling. His eternal home is in heaven, but he came all the way down from heaven to be among us in all of our filth and our dirt and our wandering and our confusion and in our loneliness, our state of despair. He came to live with us who are dying, who, if we don't, if something doesn't change, we're going to die alone, apart from God, in our sin. And so Dr. Murphy's holding this filthy woman's foot. He treats her infection. He shows her kindness. He tries to relate to her. And in doing so, he gives us this picture of Jesus. It's not the intentions of the writer. Dr. Murphy's not even a follower of Christ, not even in the show. But even still, we have this almost allegorical quality of how he shows us what Jesus has done for us. It gives us a deeper appreciation for our Savior. Now, as Dr. Murphy's treating this woman, a homeless man wanders into the mobile clinic. And Dr. Clue and Dr. Murphy see him go in there like, hey, you can't do that, excuse me. And they run in to follow him. And this guy is all confused. He doesn't know what's going on. But he knows he needs help. And he grabs this big armful of medicine. He's got all these random medicines. He doesn't know what they are, but he just thinks medicine is medicine. Doesn't matter what it is. A pill has got to be good. And so he's got all this medicine. And they try to calm him down and get to know who he is. And his name is Harry. He introduces himself as Harry. And obviously very confused. Dr. Murphy thinks he must have schizophrenia. And they're trying to help this guy. And then the guy lifts up his lip. And he's got this horrible infection in his gum. And Dr. Murphy's like, oh, that smells terrible. And so something is seriously wrong with this guy. And then they sit him down. And he complains of having this stiff neck. And he's got soreness in his neck. And Dr. Murphy hands him a cup of water. And when he reaches for it, his eyes and his hand don't line up. His hand-eye coordination is not good. He can't grab the cup. And then they kind of have to give the cup into his hand. And after seeing all these different symptoms, Dr. Clue thinks that he maybe has bacterial meningitis. And he's like, we got to get him back to the hospital and do some tests. And Dr. Murphy's like, that's not a good idea. Dr. Andrews would not approve, you know. And Dr. Clue doesn't care what Dr. Andrews thinks because Dr. Clue is out the door. This is his last day at work. If you remember back in the series earlier, he assaulted Dr. Coyle, got fired for it. Then he tried to sue the hospital. They gave his job back. But now they all resent him. And Dr. Andrews in particular wants to get him out of there. And so he's transferring to Denver. And this is his last day in the job. So he doesn't care what Dr. Andrews thinks. And he persuades Dr. Murphy to bring Harry back to the hospital to run tests. So they see if his bacterial meningitis. Well, it turns out negative. He doesn't have this meningitis. Dr. Andrews finds out about the tests, wasted money on this homeless guy, and he's furious. And he's going to call Denver, and he's going to end Dr. Kalu's career. This is the death of Dr. Kalu's career. He's done. And so Sean and Jared are sitting together, kind of reflecting on what just happened. And Sean says, Dr. Murphy says, don't worry, Jared. You're still young. You can still fulfill your potential somewhere else. I think one day you're going to be very happy. And of course, Kalu's not in the best mood right now. And he says, you're worried about me being alone, the guy going to a new job, not the guy facing death, the guy who mentored you? Dr. Glassman's not facing death. He's facing death, Sean. And that's all he's thinking about. Every time he sits alone in one of those waiting rooms, in one of those doctor's offices, every time he's sitting alone, all he's thinking about is he's facing death. And then Kalu looks at Dr. Murphy and he says, are you scared? You think that by separating yourself, you're making it easier? And then Murphy admits, well, yes, it is. For you, Sean, it's easier for you, not for him. Well, Dr. Murphy just ordered this new medical book. It's about this thick, and it probably costs $1 million. And he just loves this book, and he wants to learn everything he can about it. And he says, I'm going to go finish my chapter. He's just in denial, doesn't want to deal with the fact that this guy he loves so much, his mentor and friend, is dying. So he walks off. Later, he comes around. He decides he better go see Dr. Glassman. And he finds him in a waiting room. He's been sitting there all day, waiting for the next doctor to talk to him. And he's tired, and he's frustrated, and he's bored, and he's angry, and he's afraid. And he just has all these pent-up emotions. And through that all, he's alone. So Dr. Glassman's sitting there in the waiting area. Dr. Murphy plops down next to him. And Dr. Glassman has sheet after sheet after sheet of these scans of his brain, of the tumor. And he's just crinkling up one after another. He's rolling them up into balls in his hand, and then he's throwing them across the room near the wastebasket against the wall. Over and over again, he's throwing these papers. And Dr. Murphy sits next to him, And Glassman says, sitting around waiting for tests is a waste of my time, much less yours. And Dr. Murphy smiles and he looks up and he says, I told Jared that. I wanted to read my book, but he kept saying I should just be here with you. But then I realized I could be here with you and read my book. And so he opens up this big book and he's got this smile on his face and he buries his head in this book where Glassman is just angry. And he keeps throwing the papers, right? Crumpled up images of his tumor. And finally, Dr. Murphy looks up and he says, will you stop doing that? You know, it's annoying him that he's throwing this paper while he's trying to concentrate on his book. And so Dr. Murphy is with him. He's present physically, but he's not with him. He's not showing him compassion. He's not sharing in his struggle. He's not participating in his sufferings. And that's an essential part of being in relationship with people. We don't seek out suffering, but when our loved one is suffering, we share the burden. We're called to bear one another's burdens, right? We enter into that condition with that person. We go on that journey with them. That's a necessary component of love. When Murphy tells him to stop, he just looks at him. Glassman just looks at him, balls up another piece of paper, throws it again with even greater force across the room near the wastebasket. Dr. Murphy goes back to his book, and then something clicks, and he's got this big, beautiful book. He's been so engrossed in it, so preoccupied with this, all he really cares about. He looks over at Glassman, looks back at the book, and he tears out one of the pages of this expensive, beautiful book, and he crumples up the paper as he saw Dr. Glassman doing, and it's like an expression of solidarity. It's irrational, right, but it's an expression of solidarity. It's a way of him showing compassion. And he's finally figuring out, he's entering into this suffering with Dr. Glassman. And he crumples up the paper and he's going to throw it across the room like you saw Glassman doing. And his computer-like brain starts to work and you see all these figures pop up on the screen. It's like he's figuring out the angle, trajectory, velocity he needs to throw it at to get it in the wastebasket. And while he's holding the paper like this, his mind goes back to Harry, who was reaching for the cup. He couldn't quite grab it. And something registers in his mind. And abruptly he says, Harry has kaleidoscopic disintegration. We thought he has schizophrenia, but he does not. He has a brain tumor. And that's what Dr. Glassman has. He has a brain tumor. He's dying from this tumor. And so because he went into the state where he could be compassionate for one man who has this tumor and is facing death, now he's in a position where he can address the need of another man and enter into his condition and help bring him out of it. And so Kalu and Murphy, they go back to Tent City, but now it's dark outside. It's nighttime. It's dark. It's even more terrifying being there at night. And there, it's a scary place full of people with unpredictable and potentially dangerous behaviors. And Murphy starts to ask around, Harry, where's Harry? Does anyone know where Harry is? And he goes up to this woman, and she just looks scared and suspicious, and she kind of walks away. And Kalu asks some other people, do you know where Harry is? And they either don't know or they won't say. And then Murphy goes up to this guy who's standing next to a barrel that's got a fire in it to stay warm. And he says, excuse me. And the guy just takes a stick and he bangs it against the side of the barrel and makes this loud clanging sound. And that unsettles Dr. Murphy. And he tries to ask him again, excuse me, do you know where Harry is? And every time he asks a question, the guy bangs the stick against the barrel. It's making this loud clanging, ringing sound. And he says, okay, you don't understand. And the man keeps banging the barrel, and then this vicious dog comes out of a tent. It's barking and growling at Dr. Murphy, and another man starts clinging these spoons together, and all these noises are amplified and distorted in Murphy's autistic mind. And he covers his ears, and he starts to panic, and then Harry pops out of a tent. And they go to him, and they try to explain. They want to help him, but he's confused, and he's suspicious of doctors, and he tells Dr. Murphy to go away. And again, the scene gives us a visual representation of what Jesus went through during the incarnation. You go to verse 10 and 11. It says, he was in the world, and the world came into being through him, and yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, but his own people did not accept him. And here, the creator of the universe, Jesus, God the Son, who's at the right hand of the Father, he comes down to earth as one of us, but the world doesn't know him. And this great irony, if you read the Gospel of Luke, this great irony is Jesus is born as this baby in Bethlehem, right? And Caesar's taking a census. He's keeping track of every human being in his empire, and yet he still overlooks God, who come to earth. They don't recognize him. He grows up. No one thinks he's anything unusual. No one realizes who he is. And then Jesus is around 30 or so. He begins his earthly ministry to his own people, to the Jews, right? And he creates these incredible miracles and offers his amazing teachings. And he makes these bold claims about himself, that he's the Son of God who takes away the sins of the world. John says he's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He's the Messiah. He's the gate. He's the good shepherd. And he does all these teachings that correspond with all these incredible miracles. And yet, they won't receive him. They don't accept him. He's rejected by the very people that he has come to save. Dr. Murphy is rejected, not wanted. When he goes down in the midst of all these people in this homeless area in the tent city, that doesn't stop him, though. He goes right into Harry's tent, and he finds the guy's driver's license. And then he reads his name aloud. He says, Edward Austin Thomas. He says, Harry is not who you really are. You are Edward Austin Thomas. You live at 3458 Brooklyn Avenue. And then Dr. Murphy tells Harry, I have a neurological condition. I will always have it. But yours can be cured. You have a neurological condition too, and yours can be cured. And so when he does that, he's showing Harry that they're the same. He is like him. Jesus came in the world to be one of us, to be human, to be among us. He is like us. And that's what Murphy's doing here. He's relating to him, sympathizing with him in his weakness. And Murphy calls him by his true name. He shows him that he's like him. And now Harry is willing to listen and to accept him. He's willing to put his trust in the good doctor. And so Clue and Murphy bring Harry back to the hospital. Dr. Lim removes the tumor. The surgery's over. And then Dr. Lim says, now we just have to wait to see who wakes up. Will it be Edward or will it be Harry? Yeah? Well, the next scene, the daughter, they're in the room waiting for Harry to come out of the anesthesia, and she kind of explains what has happened. She said he didn't trust the doctors, and he wouldn't take his medicine, and he just kept getting more erratic and more disruptive. It got worse and worse, and finally, I had to just ask him to leave for the sake of our daughter's sake, for the sake of her safety. I had to ask him to leave, and he wakes up, and he looks around. He says, well, where am I? And, of course, they tell him he's in the hospital, and it takes him a minute for things to kind of register for him, and then he recognizes his wife, and he recognizes his daughter. And his little girl says, Daddy, and they all surround him, and they throw their arms around him, and they embrace, and they cry. You know, it's this sentimental moment. And Harry now knows that he's Eddie again. He's experienced healing and peace. He has clarity about who he is. He's been reconciled to his wife and his daughter, and he's on his way home. He's been saved by the good doctor. Like Harry, we don't know who we truly are apart from the great physician who's come to save us. Jesus is our creator, and so we only understand who we are in relationship to him. And before we accept Jesus by faith, we're a bit like Harry and the good doctor. We're lost, we're confused, we're estranged from God the Father and from God's family. We're destined for spiritual death, to die alone apart from God. And that's what hell is. But all that changes when we put our trust in the great physician. Verse 12 says, but all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God. We were like Harry, but now we're more like Edward. Jesus has come to be like us. He is God with us. And he calls us by name so we may realize who we truly are. He heals us from our sin. He gives us direction in life. And in making us children of God, he reconciles us to the Father and to God's family. And one day, we're going to head home to the place that Jesus has prepared for us. We were destined to face spiritual death apart from God and God's people. But the great physician has come to save us. Near the end of the show, Dr. Glassman is in the hospital. I guess he's probably in the cafeteria sitting at a table. And he's got one of his paper scans all wadded up in his hand. He looks like he's going to chuck it across the room. And he decides to, instead he unfolds it, he kind of smooths it out, puts it on the table and kind of smooths it out. And It seems as though he's coming to terms with the possibility of death. When Dr. Murphy finds him, he walks up to him, sits across from him at the table, and Dr. Murphy just says, "Do you have my book?" And he seems just as oblivious to Dr. Glassman's condition as ever. But then Murphy says, "I said goodbye to Jared. He has to go to Denver. I need to stay here with you." Dr. Glassman says, "No, you don't, Sean. It's not up to Jared. It's not up to me. It's not up to anyone to tell you where to be. I've got a long journey ahead of me. And in the end, I've got to take it alone." And Dr. Murphy says, "Yes, I understand. I'm going with you." He's finally accepted that he needs to be with his friend and that his friend needs him. And that the cost of friendship, the cost of love, is sharing the suffering of those that we care deeply about. And even if we can't actually do anything to change the circumstances, simply being with the one that we love is vitally important. And so Jesus knows all that. Jesus gives us the example. He knows exactly what it is to be human because he came from heaven to earth to endure rejection and loneliness and suffering and despair so that when we're lonely or we're lost or we're confused or we're suffering or we're afraid of the inevitability of our death, we have the comfort of knowing that he's with us. We're not going through this alone, and he can sympathize with what we're dealing with. We may not understand why we have to endure this, why is God allowing this to happen, but what we do know is that he's with us in the midst of it. And you know, that's one of the most beautiful things about the Christian faith. We have something that no one else has from any other world background or belief. We have this assurance that in the midst of suffering, in the midst of pain, God is with us. As followers of Christ, then, we are to embody this reality for the people we love simply by being with them and not allowing them to suffer alone. Well, the last scene of the show, you know, Jared's had his last day. He's on his way to Denver. He's waiting outside the hospital, sitting on a bench. He's waiting for Claire to come out, Dr. Brown, right? Remember, they had this intimate relationship for a year, and he professed love for her, and he said that you won't love me, and so he broke off the relationship. And so Claire comes out, and he says, "Oh, Jared," and she sits down next to him, and she says, "You know, I'm going to miss having you around as a colleague." And then she kind of works up her courage, and she says, "And I miss what we had together." She says, I think maybe I made a mistake. And she asks him, "Won't you please stay?" And Jared looks at her and he just says, "No." And it wasn't mean-spirited or anything. He says, "No." He says, "Saying goodbye is hard, but that doesn't mean it was a mistake." And then he says, "You're going to be okay. I'm going to be okay." And then he steals Dr. Murphy's line. He says, "I think one day both of us are going to be very happy." And she nods, and she's tearing up, and he wipes the tears with the back of his hand, and she gives a little smooch on the side of the head, and they both stand up, and he walks away. And the show ends with Claire watching Jared walk away. It's essentially the death of the relationship. It's over. It's done. And he's gone. Well, this episode of The Good Doctor gives us a glimpse of a greater reality provided by the great physician. When Dr. Murphy went from this place of prestige at the hospital, went down to Tent City to find Harry, he gives us this allegory of how the Word of God in all his glory comes down to be among us and being lost and lonely and sinful and confused and destined to die alone. And when Dr. Murphy avoids Dr. Glassman, we're reminded of how hard it can be for us as human beings to enter into the suffering of people we love, to be compassionate and to share in those trials. But eventually, Dr. Murphy comes around. He learns to be present with Dr. Glassman, and he faces the fear of death with him. And when he does that, Murphy reminds us that as followers of Christ, we must be willing to be present with those who are grieving and with those who are suffering. That's the cost of love. And then finally, when Claire watches Jared leave, it's essentially the death of their relationship. But they're going to be okay, and one day they're going to be very happy. And this gives us this amazing picture, this allegory, that as for those of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, when a loved one dies, it makes us sad. It's hard for us to say goodbye. But yet we know, because God is with us, we're going to be okay. And more than that, we hold on to the certain hope that through faith in Jesus, both of us are going to be very happy. And so this episode of The Good Doctor gives us a richer appreciation for what God has done for us through the great physician. Thanks be to God for what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. Amen. Our offering text today is from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 7 through 9. Apostle Paul says, he's writing the church in Corinth, they're collecting this offering to bring back to the poor Christians in Jerusalem. And he says, "Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he has become poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich." So Paul's saying, Jesus, at the right hand of the Father, gave up he sacrificed the richness, the wealth of being in heaven in order to become poor, to be like one of us. And in response to that, we can give up some of our material wealth, our richness, in order to help the poor in the name of Jesus and for the glory of God. So may we give generously today of our tithes and offerings.
Without the Lord, there was no way that I could know the love that was in store for me. I see things different now. My blues have passed. The things that held me down have gone away. I see things different now. The gray is gone. And I'm looking forward. I'm a brand new day. My horizons have changed. There's sunlight even when I feel a bit of rain. This is the day God made for me. It's yesterday no more. The bitter cold I felt has wafted out the door. A warm wind now flows over me. I I see things different now. My blues have passed. The things that held me down have gone away. I see things different now. The gray is gone. And I'm looking forward. I'm looking forward. I'm looking forward to a brand new day.
All right, please stand. And of course, normally we profess what we believe using the Apostles' Creed. I'd like to do something a little bit differently today and just simply offer this prayer together that was first uttered by St. Francis of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where is injury, pardon. Where there is faith, doubt. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is dying that we are born to eternal life. As we go out from this place, we remember what Jesus has done for us, coming down from the right hand of the Father to dwell among us, to have compassion for us, to love us, and ultimately to save us. And as disciples of Christ, may we be willing to enter into and to share with the sufferings and the struggles of others, embodying the love of Christ for our brothers and sisters, our family, and our neighbors. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.
Ryan?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Bless the Lord.
I'm sorry.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Day with my strength is failing.
Cornerstone.